Hey, what's going on, everyone? This is Mitch. Good Saturday morning to you all. Hope you guys are doing well out there and having yourselves a great start to your day, great start to your weekend out there. Pretty active weekend expected in regards to severe weather. Today will be its own threat and it'll actually last into the overnight hours. And then we'll have a threat tomorrow morning, maybe tomorrow afternoon also. So we'll focus in a lot on this video on what could happen today. And then we'll give you some a little bit of information on what could happen tomorrow. But of course, tonight, we'll get much more detailed on what could happen tomorrow. We're not going to get as detailed on the ingredients for this event today and tomorrow. We did that in last night's video, really dug deep on what's really driving this. But we'll still give you some really good information, more so just some cut and dry information in this video. So with that being said, if you guys have not subscribed, certainly consider doing that. Like the video if you like it. And if you guys got anything that I can pray about or pray over, as always, please put it in the comments below. It gives me an opportunity to pray over it, and it gives others an opportunity to do so too. Asking for prayers this morning. It's our last soccer game. Starts in less than 2 hours, so I need to definitely get a move on. But it's our last game of the year, and just hoping for a good, solid game just to cap off a really great fundamental season, if you will. It's been fun. Not just for me, not just for the kids, but for me also. A little fun fact about me, I'd rather hang out with kids than I would with adults. And that's just because I got a lot of kid inside of me still. And, so it's been a joy for me. It's been right up my alley to do coaching soccer, volunteering to do it. So last game of the year, asking for prayers that it goes well and smooth and we can cap it off with a great game. So with that being said, let's get rolling. Water vapor loop. You know, we talked about it last night. We got this huge area of storms that has made its way fully into the Gulf of Mexico. It's right here in kind of like the north central area of Mexico, right in the Gulf of Mexico, right here in this region, right there is where we have some powerful storms in the northern sections of this area. These will continue. They will kind of reform in certain areas, but in general, they'll work their way this way. You could get some more intense areas right into this region. And then we have to watch to see if additional storms develop ahead of this line of storms. There's a lot that could be going on today. There's going to be an area of convection here in South Georgia also. And then eventually, as this blob, if you will, of showers and storms kind of slams the peninsula of Florida, the Big Bend areas, and the west coast of Florida, you could have an additional area along the actual low pressure that could develop here in Mississippi and Alabama a little bit later this afternoon, this evening, and could provide another round of storms. And this will actually be the energy that trails into Georgia and the Carolinas, creating the potential for a severe weather threat for tomorrow. So I know this is all over the place, but hopefully it makes sense to you folks. So let's get rolling. Let's talk about the Storm Prediction Center, the latest update. This is not upgraded to an enhanced risk. Remember I talked about last night how I thought it potentially could, and it could, an hour or two after I drop this video, you know how it goes. Normally they do stuff like that, but of course they don't go off their updates based off my videos, but we have a slight risk and really nothing's changed. Honestly, nothing. Slight risk down here for Florida, southern areas of Georgia, marginal risk all the way up to Columbia. And we'll get a little bit more detailed on this when we talk about the southeast here in a second. Flash flooding risk, you got a slight risk in this yellow area. That's at least a 15% risk of flash flood guidance being met. So, you know, could get a lot of rain in these areas. A couple inches of rain is certainly possible between now and the next 24 hours. And, you know, some areas could get more isolated regions, maybe several inches of rain, depending on if showers and storms continuously go over the same area, train over the same area, if you will. All right, so let's talk about the southeast. There's a slight risk. That's level 2 out of 5. That is in the yellow region that you see on your screen. In South Georgia and a large portion of Florida. This does include Tallahassee, all the way to Jacksonville, Gainesville, all the way to Disney World, Universal Studios, Orlando area, Tampa Bay, and all these regions into here. You know, includes the whole entire Big Bend area, the eastern panhandle of Florida, down the west coast of Florida, and the east coast. So what's the main driving threats today? Tornado risk. In this brown, you have a 5% risk of a tornado within 25 miles of any given location. So in the green, you have a 2% risk of a tornado within 25 miles in a given location. So this is not upgraded, uptrended at all. Still got the 5% risk. This has not really changed much. Health threat, Still got the 15% risk of hail in excess of 1 inch of diameter or larger in this yellow region. So, you know, you're going to have the potential on the east coast of Florida once again, especially, and then also the southeast coastline of Georgia to see some large hail with these storms, especially if some storms could fire up ahead of this main line moving in this morning and early this afternoon. Wind threat, I kind of mentioned that, you know, I thought, hey, if this is going to go enhanced, it would probably because of wind. But as of right now, you still just got the 15% risk of winds pushing 50 knots or higher in this region. That's around 55 to 60 miles per hour. There's definitely going to be some damaging winds with this for someone. I think they had a report of 100 mile per hour wind gusts in an area of southeast Texas last night with those storms. Very intense. And it's rocking and rolling in the Gulf of Mexico as we speak right now. How this can unfold, we'll take a look at a broad look, and then we'll zone in or zoom in on different regions. So if you are having a hard time visibly seeing what's going on, trust me, I'm going to zoom in, so hang tight with me. But this moves in, this area, a large area of storms will continue to trail across the Gulf of Mexico. You know, if you're wondering what time frame we're at, this is an Eastern time, 11 a.m. So if you're in Alabama, Mississippi, things like that, it's 10 a.m. But you continue to move this forward. We take it all the way to about lunchtime, 1 p.m. These storms are beginning to knock on the doorstep, on the front door, if you will, of the Big Bend areas of Florida, west coast of Florida, and areas of the panhandle also. Well, you could be having some ongoing convection showers and storms in the panhandle of Florida at this time. But we'll speed this up because we're going to zoom in on this. And then by the time, you know, we get into this afternoon, you got two things going on around 3 or 4 p.m. You got an area of convection, a blob of showers and storms could be producing some hail, some gusty winds, maybe an isolated tornado threat developing along this low pressure. And then you got this lead wave that is about to slap the peninsula of Florida pretty good here. But then look what happens. You almost get like a transfer of energy. This weakens and then this strengthens. This is why you have a hail threat. These storms could be quite intense all the way from the low country of South Carolina, right in the spine of the east coast of Florida. And then this kind of trails off through. This could bring some showers along the coastal regions of the Carolinas overnight tonight. And then we'll watch the rejuvenation of storms, things like that. And then as we're getting into about 4, 5, 6 o'clock in the morning, tomorrow morning, low pressure riding, sub 1,000 millibar low pressure, you know that's a decently strong land low pressure. And then you got a lot of, you know, it's a favorable time of day for no severe weather because it's in the morning. It's 5-6 o'clock in the morning, but still low pressure right here, 996 millibar low pressure based off the HRRR model. I would watch these storms right here in eastern and southeastern sections of Georgia, and as they move into western areas of South Carolina, and any kind of storm development waking up tomorrow morning along this low pressure. We'll talk about that here later in the video, and be watching these storms also in the peninsula of Florida as we're waking up tomorrow morning. They could have a tornado threat with them. But a little zoned in look at this. Here comes the big line of storms. The latest HRRR model keeps it a little bit more intense for like the Big Bend areas of Florida. But I would say around 3 to 4 p.m. this thing is moving in. I wouldn't be surprised if we see some very photogenic, what we call shelf clouds, which is normally the leading edge of the clouds ahead of an intense line of storms. We could have some big time shelf cloud pictures showing up if anybody's vacationing along the Big Bend areas of Florida and then into the west coast of Florida. This could be an intense line of storms that moves in anywhere from this portion all the way to the Tampa Bay region. This kind of slams kind of the northeast coastline of Florida, moves in, and you can't, you know, disregard the severe weather threat here in southern areas of Georgia too. This afternoon could have some showers and storms. You will, just how tense will they be? And then we just watch. Do we have storms that really get going ahead of this line of storms, or do they kind of attach themselves? If they can get going before, then you're going to have a higher chance of some supercells, which means they could attach to a sea breeze, cause an isolated spin up, could have some large hail with this. You will probably have some large hail with this, and you got to watch out. But the latest run of the HRRR model kind of has an attachment of these storms, which might kind of limit the tornado threat, things like that. But you know, you get into 6, 7, 8 p.m., these storms are kind of starting to weaken, but you got to watch some storms in the low country of South Carolina later this evening too. And then we'll flip, and we got to figure out this area right over here, and that's what we'll do. And but quickly, I do want to mention, on approach of these storms, their low-level jet will be increasing to 30, 40, maybe at times 50 knots. So what does that say? That means that there is going to be a damaging wind threat with this line of storms. But I would say the low-level jet is lagging behind the main convection. If it wasn't, then I think you would have a bigger damaging wind threat. But this is why you can't rule out any type of isolated rain-wrapped tornado and all the shower storms, blob of convection over north central and northern Florida, southern Georgia this afternoon, because this low-level jet, favorable wind profiles aloft, will be getting ramped up in this region for sure. Let's talk about this area behind this main blob of energy, if you will. I would say sometime just after lunchtime today, some shower storms could get it going in eastern areas of Louisiana, all of northern Louisiana, southern Arkansas. There could be a lot of cold air aloft with this because the low pressure is real close by. But ahead of this low pressure, and you can actually see the spin a little bit right into here, as we're getting into this evening, I would watch any of these cells, Meridian, down the Gulfport, down the Mobile, Alabama, getting into the Tuscaloosa area, Montgomery, eventually as you get late in the evening after the sun goes down. I know this doesn't, this doesn't look overly impressive, but there will be, I would say, more of a favorable wind profile aloft for some of these to be spinning. There'll be a better low-level jet. So favorable kinematics. I try not to use that word too much because I know that's kind of a weather nerd term, but you got thermodynamics and kinematics, and wherever they overlap the best, that's normally where you have your biggest severe weather threat and typically your biggest tornado threat. But I would watch these. So please be aware, areas of Mississippi, especially Alabama, into the nocturnal hours overnight, for any kind of isolated spin-ups with these, especially the further south you get, where there's better thermodynamics, better surface moisture, higher dew points, higher humidity, I would watch down here. There could be a tornado threat that gets going overnight tonight with this second round of storms, and this will eventually trail off into Georgia, into the wee hours of the morning. And I would watch again in South Georgia into the after midnight time frame tonight. I certainly would. But the updraft felicity swath through the entirety of the event, you got to take this, seriously out here, because some of these could be spinning. It's not a strong signal for any kind of rotating thunderstorms, but there is pockets of spinning updrafts up here. So certainly watch out for this. So let's go on to talk about the Northeast. You're dealing with some showers, moderate rain at times here in the interior Northeast, the coastal regions. New York City waking up to some rainy conditions, Long Island, New Jersey. This will continue to kind of track throughout the morning, early afternoon hours into New England. It's raining basically from southern New England all the way up into the northern country of the northern sections of New York State, Vermont, New Hampshire. And I think as we move a little bit later into the evening, overnight hours, you'll definitely be getting some rain shower activity, maybe even some higher elevation snow into kind of southeast sections and southern sections of Maine. And then you'll get another area of showers, maybe even a rumble of thunder that makes its way through, like Pennsylvania throughout the wee hours of the morning. As you're waking up tomorrow morning, we'll be dealing with some more rain, another round of rain tomorrow morning for many areas, all the way from, Pennsylvania through New York State. Basically, I think everybody in the Northeast could be damp, at least get some kind of rain shower activity between now and the rest of the weekend, to be honest. But rainfall between both the Southeast and the Northeast, you certainly could get some areas could get another half inch, 3/4 of an inch of rain here right around the New York City area and everybody around. It's raining right now, so some of this is accounting for what's falling. But, anywhere from a half inch to maybe 2 inches of rain is possible for maybe northern Florida, the peninsula of Florida, areas of Georgia. Certainly going to get a lot of rain, but not a ton. But you definitely need to watch out where storms kind of go over the same regions down here in this region. South central U.S., it finally chills out a little bit in Texas today. And literally, it could be not chilly, but cooler. The only area I'd watch is kind of northern Louisiana, where you could have some cold core storms. Could produce some small hail, but I wouldn't expect anything serious out of this. But as this heads to the east, the rest of the night into the overnight hours, pretty chill weather. Not expecting a lot. You move up here to the north central U.S. Now you could have numerous showers and storms today. They get going, in the eastern Dakotas. You could have some isolated showers in Minnesota, Iowa, more steady rain in portions of the UP and Michigan, especially northern sections of Wisconsin. You could have some cold core storms. Some of these could produce, you know, you actually look at the Storm Prediction Center, it does mention a general risk of thunderstorms up here. So I would certainly watch this. Let me get back to the frame. These little pockets up here, they could produce some small hail with some of these storms. Would not be surprised one bit in the eastern Dakotas into the western sections and southwest sections of Minnesota today. But another low pressure up here is going to produce, and just it's another just bogging down low pressure that's just kind of spinning around. So therefore, you know, as we get into this evening, maybe some rain mixes with some snow in the western UP. And then the northern sections of Wisconsin up here, wouldn't be surprised one bit. Northeast Minnesota also. And then we're waking up to tomorrow morning to maybe a pretty solid shield of snow in kind of western to northwestern areas of Wisconsin, the western UP of Michigan. I would not be surprised. In fact, I'm going to do this on the fly because I wish I would have had it pulled up. But you look at snowfall forecast for this area from the National Weather Service. Let's go to the north central, doing some of this on the fly, the upper Midwest. Go down to snow. If you're ever wondering how I set up these videos, this is exactly how I do it. And wow, I'll be completely honest with you. I did not realize they were expecting this much snow in this region. Goodness. Okay. Was not expecting this. I'll be the first to admit that I did not look into this before I started this video. So you certainly could get a doozy of a winter storm up here in the UP of Michigan and northern Wisconsin. I'll be the first to admit I did not. In fact, let's look at the watches and warnings up here. You gotta have some winter storm watches, don't you? Up here? No. Winter weather advisories. Oh, okay. All right. Very interesting. But hey, let's start from this. Between now and the next 24 hours, the National Weather Service is going for 6 to 8 inches of snow in the western UP. You know, 2 to 4 or 5 inches of snow in northern Wisconsin. I'll be honest, guys, I didn't know they were expecting this big of a storm up here. I'm very surprised there's no winter storm watches, and that's probably why I didn't look into it much. I mean, I've been so focused on the severe weather threat and have had a lot of other things going on. So I do apologize because I got a lot of faithful viewers up here. And yeah. We'll talk on this tonight. I'll do some research, see exactly what's going on, but I would say some lake-enhanced action is probably a player here. But you go all the way through Tuesday morning, I mean, certain areas are showing over 2 feet of snow getting into the first couple of days of May up here. So I'm making sure I got all my stuff right here to make sure I don't have it in, like, millimeters or something, but I surely don't. Okay. All right. That's pretty wild. The southeast will be the warmest. South Carolina will be the breadwinner, probably one of the warmest portions of the country today. In the eastern U.S., it'll be very warm in Florida also, probably warmer. Cooler in the upper Midwest, and, you know, ahead of a late-season crazy winter storm that I guess is going to happen that I was not aware of. And then the south central U.S., 60s and 70s. I normally take pride in knowing what's going on in all areas of the country. And that one definitely snuck up on me. But cooler day because of rain, cooled air up here in the northeast, 30s, 40s. Definitely just a cool day. But it'll warm up nice all the way up into the Delmarva area, 60s, maybe some low 70s. A pretty nice day in the southern sections of the country. So tomorrow, I mentioned it, and you know, here it is. You got a slight risk now up for eastern North Carolina, even southeast Virginia, including Virginia Beach, the Norfolk area, and then southern areas of Florida have that slight risk. And you got two, you basically got a bimodal threat of a 5% risk of a tornado in the brown area. So watch out for that. 15% risk of winds 50 knots or higher, and then the hail threat will be kind of low. But here it is. Two tornado risk in this region. We need to watch out for this for sure. And you look at the latest HRRR model, long range, low pressure flies. I'll admit, you know, the low pressure actually looks further east, further southeast, which actually would be a good news for severe weather. But I'm going to chase tomorrow. I don't know where exactly I'm going to chase. Will I stay closer to home and kind of follow some of these storms right near the low pressure? Or do I go to eastern North Carolina? It just depends. But, you know, you're getting into 8, 9 o'clock in the morning tomorrow morning, low pressure riding out of Georgia into South Carolina. And two things you watch. One, is these storms right into here? Do they fire up some kind of tornadic activity right into here? Right here, like kind of early in the morning. Well, I would say early-ish in the morning, early afternoon. I would say the morning threat would be probably in southeast North Carolina, maybe even far northeast in eastern sections around the Myrtle Beach area of South Carolina. But another area I want to watch also is any kind of storms right, and this is right over my neck of the woods, just southeast and east of the low pressure right into here. These will have maxed out kinematics because it's right near the low pressure, the best forcing. But, you know, it's in the morning hour. So I would watch out the Midlands of South Carolina too, Eastern Midlands with this low pressure. And then we watch for the rejuvenation of showers and storms later tomorrow afternoon. Does the atmosphere destabilize in Eastern North Carolina? If it does, you could have the potential for a significant tornado threat. Low pressure, 989 millibar low pressure. Kinematics will be probably outrageous in this region. But what about the thermodynamics, which is how much the atmosphere unstabilizes? So it could be a dicey time frame. The severe weather threat has increased like we kind of thought it would. And we need to watch Eastern North Carolina and Southeast Virginia tomorrow for some tornadic supercells. Updraft Felicity swath between now and tomorrow evening. It shows a favored area right along the track of the low pressure with some updraft. some updraft spinning in this region, so we'll watch out for this. And then the significant tornado parameter, we're getting into about 8 a.m. The low pressure right in here, like I said, just southeast of a lot low pressure. You got some readings above 1, 2s, 3s. This tells me that the atmosphere could be favorable for, the ingredients could be favorable for a tornado. Into the eastern Midlands, then it gets into the PD, then it gets into the coastal plains and the sand hills of North Carolina, and then we're getting into the afternoon hours, and then this is when we watch low pressure right in here. We watch for a tornado threat here in eastern North Carolina tomorrow into southeast Virginia. So that's all I got, guys. Thank y'all for tuning in. I'll be with y'all this evening. We'll try to figure it out, and I'll be a little bit more prepared for you folks in the upper Midwest with the snow threat. God bless all y'all. Have a great day.